गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स. एथिक्स इन महाभारत ऑन द सेम सीरीज. दिस इज माय फिफ्थ लेक्चर. एज यूजुअल व्हाइल टेलिंग दिस स्टोरी माय ऑब्जेक्टिव्स आर टू. द फर्स्ट ऑब्जेक्टिव इज टू नैरेट द स्टोरी एज इट इज दैट इज अवेलेबल फ्रॉम द ओरिजिनल टेक्स्ट ऑफ महाभारत रिटन बाय वेदव्यास. द सेकेंड ऑब्जेक्टिव इज ऑफ कोर्स to take the story as a case or an illustration and discuss ethical issues prevailing in that particular story. Here today, the story which I am going to tell is about Prithvi Maharaj. In this story, I will be discussing two important aspects. The first is whether king's powers are absolute. Which means that, say, let us understand, there is king is on one side, people are on the other side. King is abdicating his responsibility and if he is not taking care of his people. At the time, whether the people have the right to dethrone the king and establish a new king in that particular place. Or in other words, whether the powers of the kings are absolute or his powers are limited by dharma. This is a story. This is the contents which we find in the story of Prithvi Maharaj. The story took place long, long back. It was in Krita Yuga. We are having four yugas. One is called Krita Yuga or Satya Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, and Kali Yuga. We are in Kali Yuga now. 5,000 years elapsed so far. Prior to that, there was Dwapara Yuga. Twice the age of Kali Yuga, and thrice the age of Kali Yuga is Treta Yuga, and four times of that is called Satya Yuga or Krita Yuga. This story took place lakhs of years back, that is called in Krita Yuga. So here, there was a king by name Venu. Venu was ruling the country. When he was ruling the country, he was a crude ruler. He was quite unruly, very cruel, very rude, and he was not performing any act beneficial to the people. No yajna, no yaga, no ritual, nothing he was doing. What happened was that at the time, because of this reason, the entire earth became barren. There was famine all around. People were not having any succor. They were suffering for food, water, and all these things. At the time, Maharshis got very angry and got his shoulders cut into pieces. And they killed him also in order to save the people from the atrocities of his atrocious rule. Then, after killing him, they also repented, adding that this king is not having any lineage. And they wanted to restore his progeny. They were also having one thing in their mind. The thing is that they should have a ruler also. So what they did was, they took out his shoulders, churned the shoulders continuously with pronouncing mantras. When they were churning the shoulders like this, here emerged an energetic man, and they named him as Prithvi Maharaj. The boy, when he was born, immediately was grown up personality, and he was made the king of the entire universe. He came to the power and he was ruling the country. When he was ruling the country, he found the entire earth, nothing it was giving out. People were suffering for food. He got very angry with earth, earth goddess. He wanted to teach her a lesson. So he started chasing her. When he started chasing her in his horse, the earth goddess appeared before him and she told, "Oh, Maharaj, don't blame me for all this sorry state of affairs. This is all because of your father only. Your father Venu, when he was in power, he did not do any yajna, he did not do any yaga. He was not performing any ritual. He abandoned all Vedic rituals and he was not giving any charity to any person. When he was doing like this, entire thing has become barren. I am not responsible for all these things. What I can now do is that I advise you one thing. You perform all the rituals according to Shastra. You restore the pristine of this cosmic rhythm. Then I will be giving bounty to all the people. She told like that and she disappeared. There is a reason in the argument also. He listened to the argument. He came back. He started performing great yajnas, yagas. Started giving charity. Then earth regained its what is called prosperity. It started giving everything to the people. People were also very happy with him. He was Prithu Maharaj is considered to be the first Samrat or Chakravarti for the entire universe. Because of this reason, Earth got its name as Prithvi. Like that the story goes up. When this king was ruling the country for thousands of years, in his period only, there was a rishi by name Atri. Atri, all of us know, Atri is one of the Saptarishis. We are having seven rishis, great sages in this Vaivashvata Manvantara. Atri is one of the greatest rishis. Of course, he was at the time in his Grihastha Ashrama. He was so poor. He could not feed his children also. He wanted to go to the forest and take Vanaprastha. When he wanted to take Vanaprastha and he wanted to retire for, as a saint or sannyasi in the forest, his wife came and told him, "What, Rishi, what you are telling? It is dharma, it is always dharma to distribute wealth to the children and then only go to the forest. You are so far, you are a Grihastha only. As long as you are a Grihastha, you are not supposed to leave all the people who are dependent people and go to Vanaprastha on your own. What you are supposed to do is that you have to distribute some wealth to the children. I am also dependent on you. You have to give some succor to all of us and then you can go to any place of your choice," like that she told. Her argument was also reasonable. He listened to her argument. Then how to earn money, he doesn't know. He was not knowing. Because all the time he was actually a devotee only. He was a mendicant type of person, even though he was a grihastha. He never concentrated on earning money. At that time, she only advised, "Oh, Maharshi, you go to Prithu Maharaj. Prithu Maharaj is ruling our country. He is performing an Ashwamedha Yaga now. You go there, show your scholarship, brilliance, intelligence and all these things, display all those things in the presence of the king. King will be pleased to give you all the wealth," like that she told. Atri agreed, but at the same time, Atri was having a doubt whether to go there or not. He was actually so sincere person that he doesn't want to go and beg for money with the king, in spite of that, because the dharma is there that he has to take care of his children also. So he goes to the court of Prithu Maharaj. When he goes to the court of Prithu Maharaj was very happy to receive the sage. He invited him, gave him a big seat, prostrated before him, gave him argyam, padyam and all these things. Then he stood before him and told, "Oh, my great Maharshi, what should I do for you? Please command me," like that. Then the Atri did not ask for money. He started praising the king. How he was praising the king? "Oh king, you are the noblest person upon this earth. You are as good as Brahma only. You are the Vidhata. You are the Indra. You are the Varuna. You are the Agni. All the gods put together, you only. Like that, he started praising the king. When he started praising the king, there was one more Saptarishi, one more person, Gautama was sitting. He was also a Saptarishi. He came there. He objected to the argument of Atri. "Oh Atri, what are you talking? You are comparing a mortal being with an immortal Vidhata. King is mortal. Today he is there, tomorrow he will not be there. He is going to die. This person, you cannot compare a king with Vidhata. Vidhata is a supreme personality. There is no comparison between a mortal personality and an immortal personality. How do you do like that?" But Atri was telling, as long as there he is a king, he is a Vidhata only. There was an argument between these two persons. So two persons are both are Saptarishis only, both are scholarly persons only. All the persons, all the courtiers divided into two phases. One set of people went to Atri, one set of people went to Gautama Maharshi. And there was a lot of argument, discussion. It was going on, a lot of confusion also. Which is correct and which is not correct. At the time, they only thought of inviting one judge for deciding this conversation, for giving his judgment. They invited Sanat Kumara. Sanat Kumara, who is Sanat Kumara? Sanat Kumara is a very son of Brahmadeva. He is supposed to be, he was a very scholarly person, very brilliant person, knowledgeable person, sober person. He was invited to the court of Prithu Maharaj. He came there. He sat as a judge. He heard the arguments of both persons, Gautama Maharshi on one side and Atri on the one side. Atri was telling, king is supreme upon the earth. And Gautama was telling that king cannot be compared. Atri was telling that king is supreme and he is the very Brahmadeva. He is the very Vidhata. He is the Indra. He is the Agni, like that. But Gautama was telling he cannot be. He cannot be compared with all these persons. Like that he was arguing. Then Sanat Kumara heard all the argument. All the arguments. Then he told one thing. When the dharma of the Brahmin and the dharma of Kshatriya, if they both synchronize, it is like the synchronization of the wind and the fire. Just as the fire accompanied by the wind scorches all the forests, similarly, the Brahma Kshatriya power put together, they destroy all the enemies. He told like that. Then Sanat Kumara was continued. What he was telling is that, O courtiers, O people, all the people have assembled here for discussing this point. In my opinion, the king is the embodiment of dharma. Hence, he is Indra, he is Prajapati, he is Shukra, he is Vidhata. The king is known as Virat, Samrat, Nrupa, Bhupati, and whatnot. Everything king only. Why? Because all the Brahmins, Maharshis, they will be establishing their tejas into the Kshatriyas, fearing some impending adharma. Any adharma, if it is going to take place, there should be one person who has to suppress all this adharma, adharmic people. Because of this reason, Maharshis have established their tejas in Kshatriyas only, and Kshatriyas are ruling the country. Because they have given all their tejas, the king is supreme upon this earth. The second point is that he was also telling, Sanat Kumara was telling, king, since the king adheres to Shastra Pramanas, the king is supreme and he is akin to Vidhata upon the earth. Like that he told, and he disappeared from the scene. When the judgment was given, all the persons were applauding Atri Maharshi, because Sanat Kumara has agreed to the contention of Atri Maharshi. Prithu Maharaj was very happy. He came to the feet of Atri Maharshi. He prostrated before him, told him, "Oh Rishi, you are really a great scholar." Then he gave much of his wealth to Atri Maharshi. Atri took whatever he wanted to take. Whatever he wanted to take only. He went home, distributed his children, and then he went for Vanaprastha and took as Sannyasa Ashrama. This is the story that we find in Vanaparva Mahabharata. Then after concluding the story, what does the story convey? What is this? What does the story portray? What it signifies? This we have to understand. In order to understand this, particularly, I would like to emphasize the students of political science in their master's degree, that is MA political science, they will be reading a famous story, famous theory. The theory is the divine right theory, the divine right theory of the kings. So it says that in the evolution of the political thought over centuries, means so many number of centuries, the assertion of the king over others was felt very much necessary to establish order in the society. If the king is not there, a supreme personality is not there, there will be a pell-mell condition, there will not be any order in the society. In order to have some order, there should be one supreme power. This was felt necessary long, long back. The theory says that, the divine right theory says that, the state is created by the god and it is governed by his deputy. The deputy is the king. Since the king is the representative of the god, he is the supreme authority upon the earth. This is what the divine right theory king normally we read in political science textbooks. This is the theory basing on this only. across the countries, Western countries, majority of the kings asserted lot of power and suppressed the people, particularly Stuarts of England, very famous. In Stuarts also, we have James I, he was always telling that the kings are the breathing images of God upon the earth, like that he was telling. The kings are the breathing images of the God upon the earth. And he was ruling the country like that. Similarly, we are having in France, Louis XIV. He was there somewhere in 1642 or around 1715, I believe. So up to that, he was there. He was ruling France like a tyrant. And he was also asserting this theory, stating that king is supreme and answerable only to the God, none else. But here, the Western political thought, in order to understand Western political thought, we have to go back to the theory again in order to understand this. Western political thought was summarized by one great writer, A.C. Kapoor. He has written a textbook on political science, Principles of Political Science he has written. I am having the book, 1975 edition, I am having the textbook. In page number 82, he summarizes the divine right theory that is understood by Westerners in four simple sentences. What is it? He says is that monarchy is supreme. Monarchy is hereditary and supreme, number one. Monarchy is divinely ordained and king draws his authority from the God. The third one is king is answerable to the God only and none else. The fourth one is any resistance to the law of the king is a punishable sin. These are the four things he was telling. But compared to that, if we take the Indian political thought, Indian seers were never willing to hand over the absolute authority to the kings. Prithvimara story, if you take, on the face of it appears that Atrivar is arguing the king is a very embodiment of God upon the earth, he was telling. We may get confused that divine right theory as is understood in Western political thought is also accepted in Indian political thought. No. Here, Indian political thought is pregnant with ethical values. Here, no absolute power to any person. We need to read, understand the judgment that is given by Sanat Kumara some lakhs of years back. What is the judgment he has given? He was telling two aspects he was telling. I will share the screen. You can see the shlokas. You also can see it. 1 minute. I will share the screen. Sanat Kumara, he came to the court of Prithvimaharaj. He was hearing the argument of Atri stating that the king is a supreme power upon the earth. He is a very vidhata upon the earth. He is a very god upon the earth. Like that Atri was arguing. On the other side, Gautamara was arguing that it's not like that. You cannot compare an immortal person with an immortal person. And king is not supreme like that. He was arguing. On the face of it, Gautama was arguing the way. But what Atri was telling and what Sanat Kumara was consenting with Atri was like this. This shloka is in Vanaparva, 185 chapter, 25th shloka. For the purpose of all the readers, I have put both in Devanagari script also and also transliterated verse in English. I will read out. Brahmachatrena sahitam chatrancha brahmanasaha samyuktau dahatah shatrun vanani vagni marutau. What is telling? Brahma Kshatriyena Sahitam and Kshatrancha Brahmanasaha. Brahmins, the Dharma of Brahmin and the Dharma of Kshatriya, when they synchronize, Samyuktau Dahataha, both will destroy the enemies. How they destroy? Shatrun Vanani Vagni Marutau. Just as a fire accompanied by the wind scorches the forest, similarly, Brahmins and Kshatriyas also can destroy the enemies. Here, the interpretation is something different. It is not Brahmin as a caste Brahmin or Kshatriya as a caste Kshatriya as we understand in the caste politics that is available nowadays. Here, I have written down that also. Here, what does it mean is that Brahmin or Kshatriya do not connote caste. as we understand them today. Kshatriya means protector. Brahmin means advisor. Because in those days, Mahabharata times, even Lord Krishna also tells, Guna Karma Vibhaga Yoha, Guna Karma. Guna and Karma are the basis for dividing the people into four varieties. Kshatriyas are the protectors, Brahmins were the advisors, and Vaishyas are the wealth accumulators, and Shudras are serving all these persons. Though whoever that is serving is a Shudra. It's not a, what is called born Kshatriya or born Shudra. It's not like that. Any person who is having this quality, in the office structure also we can see, there is an employer in the one office, what will be having managers, the advisors will be there, there are subordinate workers will be there, there are persons who will be doing the work for the sake of organizing everything and all these things. Four stages only. Here, no person is inferior and no person is superior like that. All are in, you know, all are according to their, what is called, their status of intellectual thing, they are divided like this. Here also same thing only. Here, whenever it is, Sanat Kumara was talking Kshatriya and Brahmana, he is not talking in the caste sense. He is talking as Kshatriya as a protector and Brahmana as an advisor. Kshatriya stands for strength and valor. Brahmin stands for intelligence and dharma. That is the thing. In the present day contest, when we apply the same thing to the present day contest, we are having a prime minister and the cabinet. Prime minister is there and the bureaucracy is there. The prime minister, if he is ruling the country according to his own dictums, fashions and all these things, he may likely to misuse his power. What he is supposed to do? He has to take the learned counsel. He has to take the advice of all the cabinet. He has to take the advice of the bureaucracy. And then he has to rule the country. This is what Sanat Kumar was telling here. Brahma Kshatriyena Sahitam. Kshatram Brahmana Saha Brahmanena Saha. This is what he is telling here. Both should be there. Because whenever a person, great personality is there, he is supreme. He is supreme as long as he is taking the advice of his people in the back. That is more important. If he ignores the learned counsel of the great people, then he is likely to misuse his power. Absolute power cannot be given to him. This is the first argument which Kshatriya is making. The second important argument, let us see, what he is telling is that there is that it is also in Vanaparva 185, chapter 31st shloka. ततो राज्ञः प्रधानत्वं शास्त्रप्रामाण्यदर्शनात् उत्तरः सिध्यते पक्षो येन राजेति भाषितम्. This is also, he is telling very, very, very clearly, he is telling, because the king is following शास्त्रप्रामाण्यदर्शनात्, he is following the dictums of शास्त्रास and प्रमाणास्. Because of this reason also, only king is supreme. That is why he is akin to Vidhata. That is why he is a god upon the earth. What does that mean in the present day contest? Prime minister is there, cabinet is there, bureaucracy is there. He has to take the consideration of all those persons, learned people, and then he has to rule the country. But again, under the framework of the constitution only, that is what he is telling here. Constitution is supreme. Not the prime minister is supreme, not the cabinet is supreme, not the parliament is supreme, nothing is supreme. Not the bureaucracy is supreme. What is supreme is the constitution. Shastra Pramanya Darshanat. This is what Sanat Kumara was telling. Because the king is following Shastra Pramanas. Because of this reason, I am giving the king all the powers here. King is supreme. I am agreeing with the words of Atri Maharshi. That is what he is telling here. So here, we need to understand these two statements of Sanat Kumara from this perspective. Any person who is ruling a particular country, he has to take the advice of his people. That is one thing. Then only he has to rule the country, number one. Not only taking their advice, but he has to follow within the framework of the constitution. That is also there. Both are there. Since the king of the times is following all these two things, one, he is taking the advice of his people, learned Brahmins, and he is also following Shastra Pramanas. That is why king is supreme. That is what Sanat Kumara is telling. Sanat Kumara was not giving any point blank. He is telling that king is supreme. As we do find in Western political thought, still 18th century, So this happened, this story happened. When it happened lakhs of years back. That is in Krita Yuga or Satya Yuga it happened. From that day, in those days only, our seers have visualized that power corrupts and absolute corrupts. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. That is there. So that is the reason why. What are the Shastra Pramanas again? Shastra Pramanas again, we have a very good definition is there in Anushashanika Parva. What does it tell? That also I have incorporated here. Anushashanika Parva, 61st chapter, 33rd shloka, it says that Aham vai rachite yukta yo narachati bhumipaha sasamhatya nihantavyaha shvena sonmada aturaha. This is what he is telling. Aham vai rachati. I am going to protect you like that, telling like that. Yo narachati bhumipaha, which king is not protecting the people? The king is not, if the king is abdicating his responsibility and he is not protecting the people by telling that I am going to protect you, then that king has to be punished like a wild dog and he should be beaten up in the streets. That is what it is. Anushashanika Parva, 61st chapter, 33 shloka is telling. That is the reason why here, whenever absolute power is given, the power is given with ethical values only in Sanatana Dharma concept. Here, power was not giving at any point of time. Absolute power was not given to any person just like that. It was given with conditions. Riders are there. The riders are that he has to follow the learned council sages and then also he has to follow the Shastra Pramanas. This is how we are having. I'll stop the sharing. So this is how Indian political thought was so mature, so ethical, so vibrant that it attracted the attention of many persons across the world. With this, I would like to conclude this, my lecture. Before concluding, I would like to give one or two questions. One question for all the persons for the purpose of answering. One question is that whether people have supreme authority to remove the king, because in the story itself we have seen the Venu was even killed by the Maharshis and his shoulders were churned and then Prithu Maharaj emerged. This we have seen. So whether the people have the right to dethrone the king when he is abdicating his activity? This is the first question. The second question is that whether what is the basis for deciding that the king has abdicated his responsibility? Every random person cannot come and tell that the king has abdicated responsibility, I am going to take action against him. It's not like that. What is the basis? What is the basis to decide? This is the second question. Then the third question is that how the ancient Indian political thought was mature and having ethical standards and it was ahead of all the times. Because in those days, when lakhs of years back, when the world as a whole, people were wandering in the forests, hunting nature of people were there, and they were there as a tribal people like that. At the time, how Indian political thought was so mature enough? This is the third question. These three questions, I would like to conclude with this lecture. And here, for reading my stories, this original story I have written as a 59th episode in my blog. For reading all my stories, you can always visit my blog, unclekatha.com, 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 you can see, and you can make comments. Thank you all of you. Thank you very much.